got the risk warning that I'm scrolling through here. And we're about done with that. Now, the theme of last week, obviously, was this fallout from the Chinese currency, and we're still kind of digesting exactly what that means for markets worldwide. The end result last week was that European stock markets closed pretty heavily lower, but actually US stock markets, despite seeing major losses, reversed sharply on Wednesday in quite a severe-looking hammer pattern that we'll have a look at in the US 30 chart. And so actually ended the closing the week higher. Now, I think a large of that is explained by the idea that that Europe, and the reason European markets have been doing well, did well for the first quarter and a bit of this year, is that basically the euro has been low. It's been low against the US dollar, but it's also been low against the Chinese yuan, which Europe does a good amount of trading with. And as of last week, with the yuan being devalued, Europe doesn't have quite the same export advantage anymore that it did with China. And because of Europe's heavy dependency on export sectors, you know, Europe closed down. But it's slightly different for the US because still it had the US dollar is pegged to the Chinese currency. And it slightly changes the outlook for the US dollar in that perhaps because China devalued their currency, that in effect would be exporting deflation to the rest of the world potentially, and also in the time being would put further upward pressure on the US dollar. And these are a couple of reasons why the Fed may decide to delay hiking rates in September, and so actually, you know, U.S. markets could stand to benefit from it. And I think that goes some way to explain how U.S. markets closed higher last week. Let's have a quick look at that candlestick pattern that I mentioned on the U.S. 30. So this is the daily chart. And you can see we've got this kind of downsloping RSI trend line that did kind of support prices. And we've had a bit of a small, wouldn't exactly call that bullish divergence, but more like a swing high in the RSI and a swing low in price, and it did correspond with this one here being the large reversal candlestick, and we've had a bit of follow through, closed just about higher on Friday, and today we're obviously setting up kind of flat on the open, slightly down. So the general scheme of things, as I see it, is that we're still inside this this trading range. You know, we're beneath the 200-day moving average, and it's kind of flat at the moment. It looks like it might be about to turn low. We've had this death cross that a lot of people refer to, where the 50 crosses below the 200-day moving average, but we're still above these lows. And to me, we're still in a trading range. We're just pushing into the bottom of the trading range at the moment, with a couple of indications to suggest that it could break, but it hasn't actually broken yet. And so, to me, after this strong rally, we could drop down to this kind of low again. But I think potentially that's around the low we're going to see in the range, and we're going to push back higher again, just with the idea that we're still in sideways markets. You can see the reverse a bit better on the weekly chart, and this is what I put in the chart forum. You can see here that got down all the way here, but actually closed the week up here. Didn't close at the highs, so it's not quite as bullish as it could have been. And of course, you still see here that we're below this 50-week moving average, which looks pretty similar to the 200-day moving average. Now, if we cross over to European markets, one of the most popular ones to trade with CMC Markets is the Germany 30, sort of representation of the German DAX. And you could see that we basically had this declining trend line. Here was the chance for it to break higher. Okay, so retest of the declining trend line, that's normal enough, but it dropped through it, didn't make a new high, and now we've made a lower high, and now we've actually made a lower low. Now, it's not as straightforward as it could be, having made this lower low and lower high. We're not immediately into downtrend territory because we've got this 200-day moving average, which has supported the price twice on both Wednesday and Friday. As I mentioned in the chart forum here, I tend to think that the fact that we broke this low and the fact that we've made a lower high here and the fact that we've got this RSI rising trend line here, which here I've drawn it the connecting these first two lows. You perhaps could have done it connecting the last two lows down here. It's materially the kind of the same. Both were broken to the downside. And I sort of think that even may we may get a bounce perhaps towards this gap that we saw last week. I still think that this sort of general direction is down. But it's choppy. You know, if you sort of we're reading the last bits of price action, but it's still again, if you try and zoom yourself out a bit, then you can just see that still it's kind of choppy sideways. There's not really a trend here. So my feeling is that given these last two bits of data, these last two indications in terms of higher lows and lower highs, lower lows, and just the fact that we didn't follow through on this trend line break suggests to me that we're heading back down to the 10660 low. But it's not like we're in an outright downtrend yet. We're still kind of in this choppy sideways market, as I'm trying to sort of represent to that rectangle. I just think momentum's still to the downside at the moment. Now, in terms of today's market, you know, European markets, I think, are still generally holding into the positive, but the FTSE's rolled over lower. And part of that is just because we had a lot of mining companies in the FTSE, as we've mentioned lots of times before in this webinar, and that's holding the market down. And with all this bad news out of China, you know, these mining companies are the worst performing sector. And it looks like, so here's keeping our kind of general theme here, is that we're in this kind of sideways market, where we had a bit of a false breakout after the election, but it hasn't followed through, and we're still kind of sideways. Beneath this, above this low and above these lows here, we're still kind of sideways. But as you can see here, if this is a false break and we're heading back into the range, there's a good amount of downside potential here. And if we flip down to the daily chart, something I've been eyeing is this triangle pattern here. And it looks like today that we're trying to break through it. Now, we haven't closed today, so bear in mind we could see a sharp reversal higher. It's quite normal to see that. That would be a false breakout and would catch a few people selling before the close of today. So we haven't happened yet, but if it were to close below today and we were seeing a breakout from this triangle pattern, then something to bear in mind is given the height of this pattern, and given this is a breakout area, 100%, so that whole height there projected from the breakout area would take us down to about 6135, and the low from back in December 15th is 6125, so just 10 points below. So it's right in the same kind of area. So a confluence of potential support areas down here, suggesting that we could actually have quite a steep move lower in the FTSE. That's just something to bear in mind. And if the market does close down here, we start approaching these lows, it's just a fact to consider. We could bounce off these lows, but just consider that overall pattern scenario as something to bear in mind in terms of your trading strategy and where you're taking your profits and where you're cutting your losses. In terms of drivers this week, specifically looking at the FTSE 100, which we were just referring to, the UK inflation data is out tomorrow. And then we have UK retail sales data on Thursday. So these are a couple of big ones that I think, economic data-wise, that would be pushing the FTSE around, as well as the British pound, obviously. And then we've still got a few significant earnings reports, still not out of earnings season yet. So we've got this is something I can put on insights as well, but we've got Bovis Homes reporting today, got Persimmon, Carn Energy, John Menzies, Admiral Group, Rank Group, Sports Tech, Premier Oil, Quindel, and Yeah, a few reports that could make a difference to the FTSE here. So we did just touch on the British pound briefly there. Let's switch over to currencies. Now, we obviously recently had the Bank of England and sort of mixed messages from there. Still probably not a changed outlook from the idea of a rate hike at the turn of the year, which is what Carney mentioned the week before last. As of these Bank of England minutes, it still looks like the economy is doing well, but inflation is still being held down by the sort of supermarket price war and falling oil prices. And they're just looking for signs that core inflation, which strips out the oil price specifically, is moving towards their target, and that's just not quite happening at the moment. But they predict it will at the turn of the year. So that's actually quite positive for the FTSE 100 on the base of it, that there's not going to be an immediate hike in interest rates. But as far as the British pound, it's not quite so positive. It's, you know, the British pound against a basket of currencies, other global currencies, is strong, but against the US dollar, the general feeling is that probably the US are going to hike first. So this is the resistance that we're running into at the moment. It's pretty strong around 157, and we're coming off there again today. We had this false break from this low at the bottom of the range. So you could either use that low or this low. Fake low there, retest of the line, and a move up to the resistance. But I would argue that that false break lower has run its course now that we've hit the resistance again. So that kind of false break trade is kind of over. Here we had a big kind of bull engulfing, if you're talking about the body. That retrace, that trade's kind of over as well, I would suggest. We need basically a close. I mean, it could just be above, which I've kind of drawn these lows as I think is the basis for where we started this resistance. So we could just get a close below above 156.70, and that might be enough to push us higher, but probably more confident you'd have to be a close below above 157 to suggest that we're out of this trading range. And, you know, given the strength and how many times this resistance has worked, I would suggest if we do close above, that would mean a push straight pretty quickly up to 159. You know, the more times a resistance line gets tested, the more significant the eventual break. Little bit of indication from the RSI that for a little pop higher here that we could be about to see a breakout. But for the time being, you know, we're in a sideways range, and I think if you're buying a dip down here, it's risky because that's just the middle of the trading range, and it could just drop straight to the bottom again. And you're, you know, if you're buying there, there's nothing to really tell you that it's not going to just fall away from the resistance again. So your risk reward is 1-to-1. You know, you may as well be selling at the top of the trading range, buying at the bottom, with the idea eventually one of those trades will be wrong when it breaks out. Now, flipping over to the euro, we don't have too much in the way of European data, just mainly PMIs, which come in on Friday. Now, the euro also is in a kind of sideways range, you know, pretty much defined by 108 at the bottom, 114.50 at the top. Now, we've had a pull off the low here, you know, a higher low. We've had a higher high, and now we're just pulling off from this high made in on July 10th, and potential support coming back in on a retest of this declining trend line, which matches quite well. The breakout here matches quite well with the RSI breakout, so something in and around the 50 level could be support on RSI as well. So if you see a bit of a turnaround taking place, either on the shorter term charts, or just, you know, waiting for a close above that trend line after a touch, that could be your first sign that momentum's changing and this correction's over for another push higher. So logically, we are looking for a touch here and a move up to the resistance again, that could fail. But if it should make it through, then I think that puts us likely for a move up to the top of the range, you know, 114 to 114.50. UK inflation data could do it, but I would suggest probably the big event for this week that would make the difference to the euro and to the British pound. So as I was going to say, the PMIs could do it, but I would say before we get to that on Wednesday, we've got the US Fed minutes, and that's probably going to be the critical event from this week. Now, they are a little bit stale because that Fed decision took place before the recent China devaluation, which is a big factor in whether they would actually want to make a move in September. But we will get the Chinese sort of stock market turmoil was happening at the time, and the statement sort of suggested they were considering it, but it wasn't like a major reason for them to not hike interest rates. So how they weigh up the falling commodities, the risks in emerging markets against sort of tepid recovery in the U.S., with just a strong labor market but poor wage growth is anyone's guess. And so, you know, there hopefully will be a few clues here to tell us how close a September rate hike is. How likely a September rate hike is, rather. The other major pair to look at here is we're just basically trying to push through 125 as the big round number. You know, just beneath 126 was the multi-year highs. 125 is the round number that's getting a lot of selling into at the moment. Still, the trend is distinctly higher. You know, it's a risky bet to go against this trend, but there are signs that it's sort of losing momentum a bit, not really managing to hold above 125 for the time being. But no obvious signs of a reversal per se. Still edging out higher highs and higher lows to some extent. I think probably you'd need a move below 123 at this stage to feel that actually a move back down to beneath 121 is on the cards. Now, jumping over to commodities is one of the big concerns in the market at the moment because there's just an absolute rout taking place. But actually, crude oil looking very weak, but it is now at the March lows. And so that's a potential area of support back at the old low. And gold and silver starting to show signs of some sort of strength. So if we have a look at gold. So we had this triangle pattern that was sort of widely discussed, posted about in the chart forum on a few occasions. It's basically run out of steam. I would cite the reason as this low here from November is the kind of two areas of support that on the retest could be resistance, support turns to resistance. I think perhaps this doji from Friday would indicate that maybe, and we're seeing it a bit so far today, is that downside correction's already starting to run out of steam. It was a sort of dark cloud cover pattern, which is not nearly as strong as something like a bearish engulfing pattern. And I would think that maybe we've got a chance to push up to that 1130, 1132, I think is more precisely what it is the low from November. And then there's actually a confluence potentially of resistance from this declining trend line through the lows here that was sort of supporting this sideways market before we saw the big breakdown. And so I think that that could be, you know, where we hit the March low and that declining trend line. Should we get up there in or around the sort of 143 is potentially quite a big area of resistance, and we could see a much steeper pullback from there. Whether we push down into new lows from there, we can't tell at that point, but we can think of that as a significant level that could cap the upside, at least in the interim. So silver's actually, so silver has a sort of similar looking chart, and it's actually the rebound that we've seen recently has been basically, you could say, stronger than the one in gold, because we never actually, so here's the low, we never actually made a new low beneath that September low, as in gold we did. And while I was talking a lot about this kind of bullish divergence on the RSI, that's played out nicely. We've pushed above that declining trend line, but we haven't quite made it up to this potential confluence of sort of lows and highs back beneath 116. We haven't quite made it there yet, because these are kind of the equivalent lows in silver, if you like. And we've made it through there, but we've just not quite made it through this this April low, and that's capped us so far. And it could take us back down beneath 115, because we've had a couple of days of declines here. That said, gold and silver do tend to move in sync. So, you know, if we're going to see gold pick up from here, we could see silver do the same. But just based on Friday's close, it looks a little weaker than gold, just because it just largely because it moved up a lot more. It's probably going to come down a bit more in the correction. So there was whereas gold had a sort of triangle pattern, silver was more of just a kind of, as I mentioned in the chart forum, more of just a kind of clear-cut double bottom, where that was the first low, that was the second low, this was the neckline. I mean, that was the day that we broke through that and the declining trend line. So I think a move back down to the neckline potentially could, again, be a sort of resistance turn support situation. So of all the commodities that that people are worried about in markets, oil is almost certainly top of the list, not only because of the oil companies that are listed in the stock exchange that get weighed down every time oil drops, but also just because of its effect on inflation and how that's affecting central banks and their interest rate policy. So I did an update on WTI today, just because that was the one that was weakest last week, when it ran into those March lows. So it did make new lows, but it formed a little kind of doji candlestick there, showing a bit of uncertainty. And so I think we've got a bit of RSI bullish divergence here. Certainly nothing enough to trade off. You know, that's just a doji is just a sign of uncertainty. This trend line can easily break. And we've made new lows, and the trend is very much down. But just a couple of little signs that maybe momentum's waning a little bit. But I think still the path of least resistance is down, and it seems odds on that we're probably going to get a retest of 40 before any kind of substantial bounce. Brent looks kind of similar. Here I've got it on the shorter time frame here, and this is just I actually referenced this in the video snapshot, so I'll post that on Insights again as a reminder on the YouTube channel. It's there too, and just talking about I think actually I had it labeled as 50 on the chart, but really it's 51 is the kind of top of this recent consolidation. You can see we haven't really pushed much below it. We've got down to 48. That's a good little reaction on the short-term chart here on the four-hour chart, and so slight signs of a basing here, which would be confirmed if we got above that 51, but there is some kind of fairly sizable resistance coming just above that area. So a chance that a push above 51 could get as high as 55, but still you've got to keep in mind the overall market is down. That's the four-hour period, 200 moving average. On the daily chart, the 200's way up here. So certainly in a downtrend. But this could be, you know, if we didn't get any lower here, that would be a form of double bottom. That would be a break of the neckline or the double bottom, and could indicate a push up to the high, maybe this old low here. So, yeah, labeled as 50, but really 51. So I don't believe there's any extra, it doesn't look like anyone's requesting any other instruments for me to have a look at here. So I'm probably going to call it a day. Summary, I suppose, is that we've got the Fed minutes. That's the big one on Wednesday. We've got some quite key UK data, the UK inflation, and UK retail sales. So British pounds could be quite volatile this week. Euro data coming in on Friday, so maybe that's when we'll see more of a move, depending on how the minutes go. You know, the minutes tend to be a bit, because they're generally around 2 weeks old, so they tend to be a little bit on the stale side and don't include the most recent data. So take from it what you may, but obviously we're getting closer and closer to that September possible liftoff date for the Fed, so anything the market can take hold of, it will do and could be cause for big momentum and big volatility in the market, something to watch out for there. Okay, thank you for attending. Jasper Lawler signing out. Good luck trading this week.